Hello world, my name is Klaus Rostl, and I'm doing 100 innovation keynotes in 100 days. Today is number 45, and today I'm going to talk about innovation in polarized environments. Now, what is a polarized environment? Let's start with that. If I go to pexels.com, where I get a lot of my free images, and I search for it, this is what I find. Now, this is not the sort of polarization we're looking for, even though the polar bears are pretty cute. This is what we're looking for. This is kind of horns interlocked, both of them kind of trying to best the other, both of them agreeing you are the enemy, you are the problem, you need to go down. Just that sort of polarization. Of course, with humans. Therefore, I use this nice Lego picture with a mime that's cut the head off the other, because that's sometimes where polarization heads you. Now, what, or rather, how do you innovate then? What do you do when this is what your organization looks like? Well, first off, you do it with great effort because it is an uphill battle. Imagine every time you come with an idea or something that needs somebody's buy-in, they're like, nope, not helping you, no. We don't want to work with them. No, we hate legal, or the marketing people are horrible, or they don't give us the right numbers, or they're just bad. It's tough. It's really tough. Now, how to deal with that? Well, first off, let's look at environments. Let's look at a good environment first. Good environment, big, nice, fat letters. In a good environment, it looks roughly like this. You have a person, you have another person, and then person B says, oh, I have an idea. I think we should take all our oat light bulbs, all our old light bulbs, not our oat light bulbs. Language is tricky sometimes. We should take all our old light bulbs and we should exchange them for newer LED light bulbs. We're going to save money. We're going to save energy. It's going to be good for the environment. Everybody wins. The other person says, I love that. I love that idea of taking the old light bulbs and instead having LED light bulbs. That is brilliant. And then goes on to tell somebody else, maybe at a meeting or a director level, who cares, says, we should take the old light bulbs and we should change them so we now have new LED light bulbs. This is when it's good. This is innovation at not necessarily its finest, but in a very, very good environment. Communication functions this way when you trust each other and when things work. Now, let's instead look not at good, but at polarized. In a polarized environment, have the same people, and then one of them says, I think we should take the old light bulbs and blah, 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 new LED light bulbs. Now, you'd think the reaction was the same. Same facts, right? Well, not so much. Because what happens is instead of loving it, the other person's like, I'm puzzled. What does this mean? This doesn't make sense. I can't make it fit. You want to take old light bulbs, fair enough, and you want to change them. And then you want cats? Like, what? How are cats going to solve the problem? What is wrong with you? Why do you think we should have cats? And then when the person goes on to tell somebody else, they don't say that. They say, we are going to have tigers. There are going to be tigers everywhere. And they're going to kill us. We are all going to die. Now, this, of course, is a slightly less optimal state of affairs, but it's very, very real. If you look at places where polarization is high, then it fails even at the communication level. When somebody says, I think we should do A, and that'll result in B. The other person doesn't hear we should do A and it results in B. They hear we should do A, or we should do C, and it'll result in F. And then they, even with that, they go to their peers and they say, what, they want to do F? They want to bring tigers into the bloody organization? What's wrong with them? And they're like, tigers, are they idiots? What's wrong? We should never listen to those guys again. They're from the outsider division or the French or the IT department. We don't care. We're never, they just want to kill the company. They're idiots. And then things start going downhill. Now, this is when it's bad. What do you do? What do you do about this if you find yourself in that sort of situation? Because these things happen. They happen in small organizations. They definitely happen in big organizations. Well, here are six ideas for you. Not the six best ideas, not the six only ideas, but six ideas. Idea number one, you can actually fix the problem. You can work on not the innovation project you want to set, you want to kind of launch into the world. You can look at the actual problems which are between the different spheres or the different cultures or the different departments or organizations, partners, whatever is involved. You can look at that. It's tough. Sometimes it's impossible, but you can try and try to actually fix that. Acknowledge it and fix it. Number two, you could focus inwards. You could say, you know, we don't care what they feel over in the training department. We're just going to do our own thing. We're the research and development lab. We're going to do our own thing. We're not going to ask anybody else because they're all idiots. We are going to do our thing, and all of our energy is going to be focused inwards. So we don't need permission. We don't need buy-in. We don't need any sort of you. We just need us. That's another way to deal with it. You can find a big outside threat. For many years, the US of A did this very successfully. They said to their own Mrs. Olson's from Iowa, you, Mrs. Olson, doesn't matter if you're Republican or Democrat, you are American first. If you don't kind of do what we want, if you don't step in line just a little bit, well, then the Russians, they're gonna nuke your house, Mrs. Olson. The Americans were very good at using the Soviets as that big threat. Slightly less good at using the war on terror, though they're trying. Now, today, the United States of America is one of the most polarized nations on Earth, if not the most polarized. Combined with the fact that it has the most power, then things get tricky. But they managed to use that idea of an outside threat for a long while very, very successfully. Because if there's a big outside threat, it's easier for us to get our common squabbles. Did they succeed with COVID-19? Not exactly. We'll move on before it gets uncomfortable. You can also do something else. You can get rid of people. You can say, you know what? We have three factions. They're never going to be aligned. We're never going to have peace. We're going to cut off you guys and move in that direction. Sometimes it's the way to do it. There are many tales of successful organizations where at some point somebody put their foot down and said, this is where we're going. I have a friend who's a successful entrepreneur, and at some point he realized that he'd reached the place in his business where he wanted to grow and to kind of expand and experiment. And most of his staff were like, no, we're fine where we are. Don't rock the boat. Don't take chances. We like our jobs. He said, but then we can't grow. I said, yeah, but you can't do it without us, and we don't want you to do it. And then he said, you know what? You know who owns the company? I do. And he fired all of them. All of them he fired, and then he started with a new team, and since they've just skyrocketed. But that takes guts. It's not always right, and it's always painful. But you can do it. Get rid of some people. You can also do something a little bit tricky. You can disguise where ideas come from. One way of doing this is, say, instead of having a meeting where everybody kind of presents their idea and then it's discussed, which is a classic in like a board of directors or something like that, then instead you can have them write them down, and then they're pulled from a bowl, and then somebody, a third party, maybe a secretary, something like that, will read them aloud. Even this simple gesture allows people to look at the idea instead of where it came from. Sure, they'll find out later there was Peter, the CMO, who proposed it, but they won't know immediately in that meeting, and then they'll have to weigh it on its own merits. Now, it sounds too simple to be true, but this is actually something that makes a difference. Camouflaging where ideas come from is one way to at least kind of combat polarization. It's not going to solve everything right away. It's not going to create world peace, but it will move the needle. Now, if you can, and this is especially true for big organizations, then I would advise that you try inspiring instead of imposing. And what does that mean? It means that when you have a big organization, or even a small one, and you want to make change, it's tempting to look at making like company-wide change and big sweeping things, and I am the CEO and we should do this. Well, that works if people are on board, but if they're polarized, it gets more tricky. However, if you can do something smaller, if you can inspire them, if you can do something within your own small kingdom, your own McDonald's restaurant, your own division, your own group, your own event, whatever it is, your own faculty, your own class even, and if you do something that's interesting enough, then others will come and say, ooh, what was that thing you did? How is it you're teaching that class? How did you sell that product? How are you booking that talent? How are you retaining those people? Can we sniff around a bit? Even if they don't like you, even if they think that you are the worst, they might still be inspired. Where if you come to them and try to get them on board, they'll be like, no, we're not listening, talk to the end. But if you do something and they come, then suddenly they'll come asking instead of being forced to listen. It's a whole different dynamic. It's a lot harder, of course. It's easy to go to somebody and say, you must now do everything I tell you because I'm the boss, or we should work together. It's an innovation project. It's much harder getting people to be interested enough to come to you, but it's also pretty powerful. Now, what do you do? I don't know. You probably have a lot of things where you are stuck with polarization in one sense or another. In your organizations, in your friendships, in your relationships, in your families. What do you do to break that? What do you do to combat that polarization? Now, you can't tell me because this is a one-way medium, but you can think about it yourself. And while thinking about it, I want to say one last thing. Something that is a good way to combat polarization, especially if you mean it. And I mean it. Thank you.